My name is Chris Wedge. I'm the director of Ice Age. I've been making animation since I was about 12 years old. My whole reason for starting up an animation company with my friends was to do cool stuff. We didn't think about how we were going to make money at all, and actually we starved for 2 years. One way or another, got to the point where our company could make a feature movie. But from the beginning, we were thinking about short film ideas. I was, anyway. I knew we were working on this lighting technology that would make it really look natural and real. Ultimately, this film became Bunny. This was just a fun little project for me to reach back and kind of explore that world that I think I just have in dreams anymore. And it won an Academy Award. Ultimately, I think we got enough attention so that we got this feature film. Ice Age, the concept was kicking around at Fox Animation, which is a division of Fox, by one of the producers there, Lori Forte. It was her idea to set a movie in the Ice Age.
I actually developed the idea, Ice Age, with executives here at Fox, and I oversaw the scripting of it, and we developed the characters and the story, and ultimately we decided to do it as a CG animated feature, and we brought Chris Wedge into it and Blue Sky into it, and it just everything turned out, everything just worked well.
So two or three things drew me to the project in the first place. One was that I thought the story had good, simple, structural bones. Characters were very well defined. They're three kind of disparate outcasts.
You're hanging out with us now, buddy. Dignity's got nothing to do with it.
The setting, the Ice Age, was an interesting one because no one had been there, really, on a movie screen.
Prepare for the Ice Age!
There was the setting, the story. The third thing was that the studio was interested in doing it, so we took the opportunity.
Yeah, mush!
I've never directed a live-action movie before, but I can imagine what a lot of the differences are. When you watch an animated film, there isn't a single thing on the screen that you see that wasn't created by somebody. Every detail in the world, the faces and expressions of the characters, what they're wearing, what they look like, the clouds, the trees, everything's created by hand. Nothing comes for free. Part of the trick is surrounding yourself with really talented people. It's a huge collaborative effort.
You've got good heft in his shoulders.
At the very beginning, I wanted, at least for the look of the world, to be as authentic as I could. So we did a lot of research early on. You know, we took trips to the Museum of Natural History. At the end of the day, decided, you know, the Ice Age looked pretty much like the world looks today. I mean, without the houses and highways, but I mean, there has been 20,000 years of evolution since then, so the animals look different. But humans were pretty much like you and me without the Walkmans. What we ended up doing was stylizing quite a bit. We took what we had learned in our research and we just kind of styled it up to suit our story. In our exploration of what animals could exist back there, we had just reams and reams of drawings by Peter DeSevres, who designed all the characters.
Well, right here, I'm exploring the saber-toothed tigers in general. The advantage is we don't know for certain exactly how the extinct saber-tooths looked. So we have the latitude to completely change the pattern on them and the color on them, and in that way we can get something a little more alien, a little more unusual.
Ooh, I can't wait to get my claws in that mammoth!
I'm trying to push it as far out there as possible. You know, obviously we want it to be unique.
Isn't there anyone who cares about Sid the Sloth?
His design is the most alien. I don't think anyone would really look at that and say, oh, that's a nice sloth. There are elements to him that are sloth-like, you know, the eyes all the way out here. But we've kind of combined a tree sloth and the extinct sloth that was like a bear, very big in the Ice Age. We kind of combined the two and come up with this thing.
You two are a bit of an odd couple.
There is no us.
There's Manny. He's been the toughest. He's been hard to distill.
You know, I don't like animals that kill for pleasure.
All my original drawings had him frowning and glowering and looking very menacing, but like most of the characters, he needs to be able to get softer and more appealing. So I have to, when I'm developing the character, I have to have both extremes in mind. For the secondary characters, we're using the weirdest animals we can find.
You can play Extinction later.
Okay.
As soon as we find something grotesque or really, really strange, we're very excited. We just think, oh, of course, that would be great.
We are the weirdest herd I've ever seen.
Evolution of Sid. Early Sid, early Sid.
Early.
Actually, it's much closer to giant ground sloth. These things were like 14 feet tall.
I don't think you would have gotten too many laughs.
Here's my definite favorite Sid of all time.
I'm Sid!
So this is Sid at the end of the movie? He's made something of himself?
Going into the big city.
He's going to
start pounding the pavement.
What happens is I'll do the sketches. From there, they hand it off to the modelers, and they will, as closely as possible, translate the sketches into a three-dimensional model.
We get those drawings, and we have modeling rounds. The director will come around, and we'll show them where we're at a certain point.
This is the final soda,
based on Pete DeSepp's drawings.
I think he looks really good. He's very handsome.
As he looks at it in 3D, we'll see things that we didn't see in the drawings.
The face should ultimately have more heft. I think he should get wider in here. Mm-hmm. His eyes should get narrower. His eyes look a little too friendly.
They have to make certain choices about editing and cleaning up the shapes. They need to simplify it as much as possible.
We can make quick changes in clay much better than the computer. So we do everything in clay.
So that's the advantage to clay. You want to get as much done in the clay as possible, but then you can finish it up in the computer.
Okay.
At the point when it's approved, we put lines on it and use this tool to get those lines into the computer. Alex is digitizing the sculpture. So he clicks along the surface at each intersection, which gives a curve, and then all those curves can then turn into a surface in the computer. Once that's in the computer, then you can scale the eyes out or do more changes.
Because they've already scanned in the model of of Diego. From there, they're hoping to be able to extrapolate on that stretch and pull and inflate and whatever, and get as many different characters out of that structure as possible.
You have a script, and the script gives you one page explaining, oh, this is an action sequence, that this would happen, that would happen. It's supposed to be set on inside this kind of environment. So it gives like specifics about what is it that makes the sequence, but it doesn't give you every beat or every moment of it. After we're done with the sequence and story, you have a storyboard. You have like a 2D art that represents how the scene would look.
Storyboards are developed by the story artists, and they pin up their boards, and usually we'll look at those together with the director and the editor, and that really becomes kind of the template for what becomes the film.
Prepare for the Ice Age!
And Sid asks,
Ice Age?
I've heard of these crackpots.
This dodo that stole the melon runs in, plants it down, sees those guys behind him.
Ah, intruder! 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 Ah!
Burn and die.
Taekwondo's! Attack! Yeah! Ah! Ah! Attack the melon!
Dodo's flying through the air and there's dodo carnage everywhere. And he knows what he has to do and he swallows hard. Oh. Mm-hmm. Okay! And he starts running. No, 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 no. The dodos are coming after him. And cut back to Sid, who's like, dodos are raining down on him. Blim, 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 blim. And it goes right over his head. Finally, he stops and he throws the melon up in the air because he made it.
Yeah. Touchdown.
Ah, Sid!
In a quick explanation, we get a character that has controls built into it. We don't actually take a raw model and start moving it around and animating it. There's a whole department that just does, they're all phenomenal artists, and they actually put controls in the characters to allow us to move things around.
Here in the rigging department, we set up the controls for the animators. This includes not only the body controls, but the facial controls as well. The controls themselves number perhaps on the magnitude of about 1,000 different animatable attributes per character. Many of those attributes involved are as simple as jaw open, right outer brow razor.
Lifting the heel off, rolling off on the toes, rolling around the foot. We can rotate all the toenails themselves.
Each animator is assigned one shot, one or two or three shots. And they would have a little paper that would say, like, this is your shot, this is what comes before, this is what comes after. It gives you the outline of everything that's happening in that shot.
It's basically an empty set, and you're kind of free to start the performance.
From the beginning, we knew that we were going to have to depend on these characters to give us a lot of the comedy. Their acting style had to be appealing enough to help keep the film light in the moments that were required.
Oh no.
Once the characters were defined, the actors were defined, we started to study them more in order to come up with the way we're going to get the characters to move. In a way, we're all like, in a way, actors, that we can make things move right. Visually, you should be able to watch the animation and relate to it, have fun with it.
The first thing that we did was create this opening sequence. I felt as though you sit down in the movie theater and, you know, you want to see Ice Age. I thought we should throw that right up there.
Well, the Scrat, right.
The Scrat, yeah. That was a real breakthrough, I think, because it was so tight in terms of storyboarding to layout to us, Bill Frake.
His boards were great.
Boards were amazing.
And we were a little bit scared that we were not going to do them justice. We always say, you know, snappy timing. It's almost like a Warner Brothers, like, very quick sense of motion and quickness in the characters.
Yeah, because, I mean, that was really snappy.
The more we pushed it,
yeah.
I mean, the funnier it was.
And then that carried into kind of like an energy for the rest of the movie.
We had a couple of performance-like constraints. One was that Manfred, just by nature of the type of animal he was, is kind of like a furry haystack with two eyes. He can't use his hands to gesture. He can't see his mouth.
You have beautiful eyes.
Basically, we had to depend on his eyes for all the acting in the movie. And he has some of the most powerful moments, I think, and they're all communicated through his eyes. We had a lot of conversation about what exactly what those eye shapes should be and how we should use them.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You know, the best references are our own faces.
Yeah, yeah.
That's where thumbnailing comes in handy. You can just draw out different little facial, you know, cartoon Manny heads and draw out different expressions.
This is an exploration of different expressions and attitudes on Manny. The trick is to somehow transfer that into the computer, but at least you're getting, it's like a shorthand, you get your thoughts down. You get fast feedback with the pencil and paper. It's immediate, it comes straight from your heart.
Where's the baby? There he is!
Cats are very tricky because they're very flexible, they're very sharp. So we really had to study them very hard in order to get like a good reference.
He was probably the most difficult to get physically right.
Yeah.
That pink thing is mine.
Plus with, I mean, they've got these big sabers. Doing the mouth shapes around these big teeth, you know, was, I know, a rigging challenge.
No one touches the mammoth until I get that baby.
I think the directors responded to the eye acting with Diego and the shiftiness. I mean, there were glances where he would, like, deliver a line and then glance away at the character.
Go get lost in a blizzard. It's your choice.
It was just little beats like that that came out, and we saw that was the direction to go in Diego.
Hey, Uber tracker, up front where I can see you.
Help me.
And for Sid the Sloth, pretty much, I think we look at ourselves for reference, because since it was like a biped kind of like character. You know, look at Leguizamo, the way he acted, just as some sort of like reference.
I mean, everyone wanted to work on Sid because he was just like the comic sidekick, and you know, there's just so much, you know, potential with the character. And John Leguizamo, of course, you know, had just all these great takes.
Fish.
And the biggest challenge, I think, throughout that process wasn't so much the animals; it was, I think, maybe more the humans.
Humans were a big challenge.
They were a challenge.
They were the most difficult because, you know, when something isn't moving correctly. I mean, Sid, we could get away with a lot of stuff because, you know, like I said, he's, you know,
kind of Chuck Jonesy or Warner Brothersy. But humans, I mean, people human movement.
We use a digital camera to shoot ourselves, like moving around, running, throwing spears, or like reacting with each other, and just trying to come up with a way to that we moved.
The process is as malleable as you can make it. And you can take a stab at a sequence, and if you don't like it, you can recut it. You can look at the animation on one day, change it, and it's a little bit different the next. It's really quite luxurious in that respect.
And I thought, whoa, she's gonna go praying mantis on me, you know what I'm saying?
Hey, if you find a mate in life, you should be loyal.
Well, I think mating for life is stupid. I mean, there's plenty of shit to go around, you know?
The very first technical challenge for us on this movie was creating a computer-generated movie that happened completely in a natural environment. It's a very small story that happens in a very big place. So I didn't want the environment, on one hand, to upstage the story at all. I wanted it to support it. So we came up with a style which is kind of the 3D equivalent to what Chuck Jones was doing in the Roadrunner cartoons, you know? They're kind of sketches and outlines of the world, and the main focus is on our actors.
Slalom, slalom, baby!
We have focused our technology effort on creating worlds that look like they're lit very naturally. The challenges for us then were to create all the detail that you see when you walk outdoors in the Ice Age. There's a sequence in the movie that happens in the water. So we had to develop ways for our synthetic actors to interact with the water, way for the water to look, for splashes to happen. There's driving rain at one point, there's sleet, there's smoke, there's fire, there's snow for sure, there's blizzards, there's driving snow, there's characters running through the snow and splashing it up behind them. We've created technology that the technical directors can use as if they were photographers.
By the time that it's handed to us, all the animation is already completed. It's just in a very raw format. And so what we have to do is add in the lighting in order to get the proper mood and feel and kind of context of the shot so that it feels like it's really outside at noon or it's early morning or you're inside of a cave.
Basically, from the art department, we're given inspirational paintings. And through that and a discussion with the director, it's up to people like us to figure out what each sequence should look like specifically. Now it's time to figure out where does the key light go, what color is it, where does the fill light, what do the shadows look like. All these things have to be figured out.
As lighters at Blue Sky, we're really lucky because our renderer is so physically accurate that we can place lights and do things just like you would in the real world, and it pretty much comes out right.
The other part that we take care of is generating all these different kinds of effects. The effects team, they work on the general motion and geometry, and then these effects come to the lighting team, and it's up to us to integrate these effects into each of the shots in our sequences.
A lot of the most difficult things that computers are asked to do, we're doing in this movie.
Mush! Or not mush, either way.
You really start this project with an idea about what you want to do. And you have to have enough belief in that idea, because that's the one thing you're going to hold on to for the whole thing. It's like kind of having a child. You know, it starts out kind of blank, and then it starts to collect all sorts of input from the environment and a lot from you as a parent. It's like creating an organism that comes to life as you're working on it and then like takes off when you're done.
Whoa! Woo! Yeah! Who's up for round two?
I think the next movie is probably bigger. We're a little scared right now.
Yeah.
It's pretty ambitious.
And we hope we don't have to do quadrupeds, but who knows? Yeah. With the success of Ice Age, who knows what's going to happen?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, so where are the sloths? You never see any sloth in these things. Have you ever noticed? Oh, look, Manny, a mammoth. Hey, look at this big, fat, ugly one. Looks just like you. It's like, oh, and he's got a family.
おい、そいつを泣き止ませろ。もう我慢も限界だ。俺だってこんなうるさいやつ初めてだ。泣き止まねえよ。まったく、ああだこうだちまちまちまちま。もう下に寝かせるんだ。なんで俺がうんちみんの。この子拾ったのはお前だし、チビでアホなのもお前。言うこと聞かなきゃ俺が殴るから。
でも。
A lot of the character exploration actually happens in the sculpting phase. The modeler's job is to create in 3D a digital model. It starts with the process of the original sketches, literally to take our clay sculpting techniques and skills and translate that into the computer. We'll sculpt what are called maquettes, which are small clay models. You go through a whole array of iterations of characters, probably 15 or 20 versions of Manny. We would sculpt it to a point where we like the character and put it on the shelf, start up another sculpt, do some more exploration. We'll draw lines on the sculpture that represent the geometry of the wireframe model. Once the 3D curves are in the computer, we'll use Maya to connect all the curves to create a surface that represents the final model. There's a lot of time spent tweaking that surface to get it just right so that all the different parts come together. That ability to see a 2D drawing and visualize that in 3D space is critical to developing the character, to bringing the character from 2D to 3D.
What was interesting about Ice Age was that we had so many different kinds of creatures to rig that moved in so many different kinds of ways. Each character was a rigging challenge. Rigging is like creating a marionette or a stop-motion armature. Anything an animator might want to move, rigging has to prepare for that. It has to create some sort of control, some sort of handle that you can grab and then cause the leg to twist, the arm to bend, the face to move. We take the final geometry from the modelers. We create a skeleton within Maya, and we use this skeleton to deform the character. There are hundreds, perhaps even, you know, over 1,000, perhaps different things that an animator could possibly animate in the character rig. What we did to deform the characters was bind the geometry to the skeleton that we created. Geometry, of course, is made up of a series of points. We could bind the points of the lower arm to the lower arm skeleton. So when the lower arm skeleton rotates, those points are going to move with the skeleton. What we experimented with were adding in cartoonish controls. For instance, when the Scrat is yanking at the acorn, his arms are actually scaling. They're increasing in length. The bones are actually scaling out. We would add special sort of deformation controls and make the eyeballs scalable, just to sort of emphasize the drama of the action or the pose.
Hey, wide body, Kermit next time! Oh, what a mess. Hey, you rhinos, you know, you have really tiny brains. Did you know that? No, it's just a fact. No offense. Well, you probably don't even know what I'm talking about.
The key is to find the balance between the voice that you get and the acting that you want to put and combine those two and make sure that those two fit together. We have a true actor delivering the voices, and we have the characters inside the computer. That's the character that we created to represent that voice. Part of the research is finding within the animator's mind the best way to act the scene out. But the key is to make sure that whatever the character is mimicking or acting reflects the emotion. The challenge within acting animation is make sure that we stay true to the characters. I think that's the biggest challenge.
On Ice Age, effects pretty much cover everything that you see moving that is not a main character. In traditional special effects, you're trying to create something that looks real. In Ice Age, we're dealing with a cartoon world. The idea that gravity only takes effect a few seconds after you fall off the cliff. A cloud of dust doesn't just woof out, it goes whoop. And because of that, the process that we went through to develop the effects was to take a basic physical model and have it emote the feeling of the shot rather than just what it would really look like in real life. In order to get this effect of this huge glacier crashing down on this poor little scrat, we took a whole bunch of different little elements, combined them together into one big, scary mush. We had to take the bow wave of the glacier moving through the snow. We took the dust. We took the chunks of rock falling all around. In order to do that, we do it in a series of layers, a series of passes that allows us to isolate each element and deal with it on its own so that we're not dealing with the weight of the entire system.
TD's place lights, much like in live action, basically defines and gives a characteristic to each of the individual lights. What the materials department does is defines all the material properties of all the different things, like the color and the texture of the skin or the quality of the rock. Materials for the shot elements are created, defining properties such as color, roughness, texture, hair, and fur. The elements now have materials, but the lighting department has yet to give the shot the proper mood and context. Simulate as much as possible kind of real-life situation, whatever the director is trying to communicate. Place individual lights in different locations, give them different colors and values to try to give the director what he wants. The warm key light simulating the sun is created. The cool skylight reproducing the bounced light of the atmosphere is added. Fill light is added to accentuate character features and readability. Shadows to give things a more dimensional feel, as well as highlights to achieve a wet look. Lastly, subtle shading and compositing techniques give the shot its final look.
One of the biggest sources of inspiration for the cave painting sequence was actual prehistoric cave paintings done in Lascaux, France, which is probably one of the most widely known sources of prehistoric art. To execute such a somber but pivotal point in the film, the directors wanted Manny's vision to feel distinct from the rest of the film. We felt that the hand-drawn 2D approach would best contrast the pseudo-realistic 3D aesthetic dominating the other sequences. Fortunately, at Blue Sky, several of our animators were traditionally trained in 2D, preventing us from having to outsource the work. Everything had to feel very fluid. In a standard animation, you're explicitly drawing out each of those frames, and to get a very fluid feel, you're actually essentially fading from one keyframe to another. This technique is called interpolation. Finally, when the technical director does all the processing, he then takes that hand-animated imagery into a 3D animation program, projects it onto the 3D background. Essentially, the really nice result of this whole process is you get this beautiful hand-animated 2D incorporated directly into 3D elements.